for those who missed it. There we go. There's our average calculation. I apologize for the camera turning itself off. Say that again? 121. I'm tempted to go with a bunch of us calculating 145. Not to be a bastard, but when 15 of us come to an independent conclusion, I'm like, I'm going to go with that one. Let's come back to Taryn's terms from before now. Turn this off for a second. Let's go back to our data. I like our data. Our data's fun. She mentioned median and she mentioned mode. These are two other ones that are very often used. Which one do you guys want to attack next? Your guys' call.
Median.
Median it is. Randomless voted. Median first. I'll draw a line here. Median, and I'll draw a line here. What's the median? What is the median? When you hear the word median, and I don't mean the median in the road. Although the median in the road is actually aimed kind of properly, really. Davidson, what do you think?
You take all the numbers in a data set, set them up from least to greatest, and then it's the one in the middle.
Good. It's literally very often when you guys think of the word middle, when you're talking about averages, you're talking about the median. Very often, you're talking. Faith, go ahead.
So that's what I wanted to do.
That's what you wanted to do. And guess what? When I said average, that's an average. It's just a very specific kind, as Riley pointed out. Michelle, go.
That's how Taryn and I did that whole data set.
All good. All good. Okay. Let's find the median in our data set. Is that cool? I'm going to pull the screen back down, and we're going to find it. But I want you to hear what Davis has said. He said something that I think you all know, but we tend to forget sometimes when working quickly. He said you take all the data and then
set it up from least to greatest.
Set it up in order, whether it's least, greatest, least, as long as it's in order, that's the important thing. Then find the middle. A lot of students will just take a data set and find the middle without sorting it, and that just gets you some random number sometimes. So let's pull out our data set again. Okay. There we go. Here we are. Now, because I like you guys, I put it in order already. It was nice to that way. Don't have to worry about sorting it that way. And we have 36 data points, which means we actually have to go into and find halfway between one of them, don't we? We're not going to find a middle. There's an even number. So for example, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. That's 18 up. If you come the other way, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. There's no middle. If there was a middle, there's only going to be a middle when you have an odd number of data points. So if I took out one of those nines, then that 3 would be the middle. That would actually be in the middle. When you have an even number, there's two middles.
Right.
So
what do you do with the two middles? You pick whatever's in the middle of those two.
Right.
That's just by definition. That's what we do. So the two middles of our data set are 4 and 3. So we actually call our median
3.5.
Please!
If we had done the mean because it was 4.02, would you pick one over the other then? If it was 4.5, you would average sometimes up to 5.
Oh, rounding is a very, this is a great question. Listen, tell me anyway.
Sandy,
thank you. I love the question of rounding, and to try to head it off, I always tell you what to round to if there's a problem.
Oh, okay.
But precision, scientific precision, the whole significant digits thing, I don't assume that we have studied that in chemistry classes. So if I'm doing independent statistics, if that average came out at 4.5, I generally would leave it at 4.5.
Oh, okay.
But because it was so close to 4, and now what does close mean? That's part of this course too, is measuring closeness and farness, or awayness and closeness. So don't sweat it, I'll tell you what to round to. This one here, 3.5, if we round it up to 4, we've negated the point of that it's being 3.5. Because if we round to 4, then it becomes this point.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just going to call it 3.5, if that's okay with you guys. Mm-hmm. Fair?
Mm-hmm.
You see the two differences? If you had an odd number of data, there actually would be one in the middle. Like this class down here, they had an odd number of data, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So they had, it looks like, 17 on the bottom, 17 on the top, and then the 18th one is right here. So their median would be that 3 right there. But your median has to fall between because you have an even number. Is that fair enough?
Mm-hmm.
I shouldn't say fair enough. Believable enough. I don't know if it's fair. It's just the way it's set up. Cool? Okay,
uh-huh.
So let's go over to the sideboard. I want to ask you how this is different than the average two. So let's keep a running total. So for the keys, let's keep the keys. You've got X bar is about 4 keys per student. The median, I don't think the median has a symbol. The statisticians used to call it X squiggly tilde, but they don't seem to do that anymore. So let's call it 3.5 keys per student. It's a little bit different than the average. We'll talk by about 0.5 key. What does the median ignore that the average doesn't? Can anybody see this at this point? You might not be able to see this line, that's okay. The median ignores something that the average doesn't. If you don't know the answer to this right now, it's totally fine. We'll get to it. Addison, go ahead.
Addison?
Addison. Addison's over there. Davidson. Addison. Davidson.
The number of people in the data set.
Oh, that's a good point. It kind of does, because it doesn't matter if this data set had 100 or 36. Assuming the distribution of the values is good. I wasn't thinking of that. That's a very good point, though. Very, very good, Davidson.
Alicia,
thanks for playing, Andrea.
Is it
Alicia.
Because we have 2 that have 0 that carry?
We do.
So in the average, though, you're still taking that into consideration.
You are.
Adding that as a total,
correct.
But in the median, you
thank
are
you.
Including that.
That's what I'm getting at. Yeah. Let me ask you guys a question. Suppose this person here that had 9 keys, I don't know who this was, somebody had 9 keys on Tuesday. Faith, you didn't have 9, you had 99 keys that day. I'm just, ow, carrying those around, right? Would the median be any different than it is right now, 3.5?
Nope.
No different whatsoever, because that's just the biggest data point value, right? Would the average change?
Yes,
because we'd have to add in 90 more to our 145, and it would go up to 235, over 36, then the average becomes something like 7 or 8 instead of 4, yeah? It basically doubles the average. The median doesn't care how big the extremes are. The average sure does. And that's one thing that's really cool about statistics is it gives us tools to measure that. Very often, when real estate folks are talking about house prices, they use medians and not averages, unless they're trying to skew the data, right? I was biking to pick up my son from school last week. I live on the northeast side of town, which is generally less expensive than the west side of town. And the northeast side in general is fairly inexpensive. Dude just built a house in my neighborhood. He's selling it for $540,000. And I just laughed out loud. I'm like, good luck with that, brother. And I have a good time with that. And I realized, I'm like, if you slap that in with the other house values in my neighborhood right now, it's wrong. It's nowhere close to it. It's like Faith having 99 keys in her pocket and everybody else having 10. It's that variant. But if you look at the median house price in our neighborhood, it just treats that as the most expensive house. It might only be $1 above looking at the median or a penny above. Doesn't care how much bigger, just that it's bigger because, as David said, you put them in order and it just puts the most expensive on the end. We'll come back to that idea later today. I want to revisit that idea. It's a very, very important idea and I want to make sure that we talk about that more.
Although, yeah. If it does sell, then it increases the value of the
house. Yeah, you're right, Scott. You are correct. If it does sell, then the comps in my neighborhood then go up. That's
not weird.
It's not weird, it's a fiction. And that's one of those things I often get in verbal fist fights with real estate people.
Right.
Well, the comps, I'm like, dude, okay. So there's perceived value and there's what you actually get for it. We're gonna look at real estate prices here momentarily, actually, in graphical form from 2009. I've got some old data I haven't updated yet. And there's what you sell a house for and what you actually get for it. I mean, he's selling it for $540. We'll see what he gets for it.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, that's the idea. The house, 2 houses down from him, the dude, this was my first time I saw a foreclosure notice in my life. This was 6 years ago. He borrowed $500,000. Now remember, I'm on the northeast side of town. I'm almost like halfway to Redmond, essentially. I mean, like I'm that far northeast. He borrowed $500,000 to build this house, put $250,000 of his own money into it. Immediately went bankrupt because number one, that's a lot of money. Number two, it's my neighborhood. I hate to be the dead horse. It's my northeast neighborhood. You're trying to sell a house for, I think he was going to sell it for like close to $1 million. And this was how crazy things were in Bend in 2006. They were insane in Bend. He went to foreclosure, sold on the courthouse steps, $206,000. That's what my neighbor Steve got it for. He was complaining about it in a meeting once. Ah, $206,000. I'm like, dude, you have no idea. You have no idea what that house has been through. Maybe you do, you didn't look at it, I don't know.